The CEOs. I was seconded from the Ministry of Home Affairs when the project came, because the project came after a research done by APCAN and Government of Kenya Attorney General Chambers about the issue of street children, and we wanted to curb the issues of street children. I was a children officer by then. So when UNICEF to response, and then the outcome of the research revealed that we need a holistic approach to poverty alleviation. So that is how CEO came, and we were seconded to come and take a training at APCAN 93. So I took the training, and
in 1993,
the first batch, that is. So after that, I went back to the ministry, and there was a request that the community organizing should stand firm in Kenya to be established. So the government was requested to release me because I happened to be we were three, the best that time. So I'm proud with you. That is why I like having a meeting so that I can tell the history. So
especially if you're the best.
Yeah. So I joined 95. And I took over from Philip Manila, Philippine patriots, the ones who were trying to establish, that is Angelina, Lily, and there were three. So after that, I managed to, we were three who were taken, but two resigned. And I was left alone, single-handed, and then we are having a team. So we trained the first batch, then I was able to train the first trainers also. That one has gone to, the Lord, one has died. I remember Nicholas, I remember Bisai, I remember Pikanganga. So after that, after training the CEOs, I also took advanced training. I went to Manila, Philippines, and things were okay.
Murphy and them.
Yeah, Dennis Murphy. So yeah. We were there. Then after that, I requested that I should be released to further my studies because I was seeing the enormity of community organizing. And that time I had first degree, so I got a scholarship to Netherlands. I did now women and development. And when I came back, CEO had to move from APCAN, and there were things like this. And I approached APCAN to come back up and said no. And so I found myself floating. Then I got an employment with ActionAid as women's rights coordinator, Western Nyanza. After that, I decided to not be toasted around. I initiated the formation of this NGO. This is
Rural. I just read his brochure.
This one.
Yeah.
I can give you this.
Okay, got it.
If you don't mind. Yeah,
Rural Women Empowerment.
Yes. We are using CEO strategies. That is what we are using.
Mm-hmm.
We start with the CEO principles, and that is what we are using. We start without no money, we develop issues, and I also support CEO. So that is what we are doing. I'm also a consultant. M&D doing a lot of monitoring and evaluation, which I normally anxiety so much, and also empowering women and girls, and furthering CEOs at the grassroots. My argument had been that the problem, urban poverty problem, originates from the rural. So, Ministerio, we said, no, we don't go to rural, but we said we are going to rural. Sorry for taking long.
No problem.
You're already sharing.
But it's good to know the history of the
Yeah.
Yeah, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
My name is Isaiah Luyara, and I'm a Copa Kenya member, and also the Secretary General. I was trained in the 14th batch at Mukoro, where he comes from. So currently I'm working at Korogocho, with the Children Organization, Olu Fanisi Center. Ufanisi is my initiative, which is started there. And there what we do is that we try to support less fortunate children. So at the center, we provide them with feeding program, clothing, and non-formal education. And we also try to go out of the way to reach their parents, especially the single parents and those who are addicted with drugs. So it is also like a rehabilitation center where they come and provide them guidance and counseling. Also try just to shape them. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay.
So,
thank you for that introduction.
and as Sammy said, my role is actually very, very simple. Just to highlight what Akon is, where it is, briefly what it is doing, and then we open up all of us also to share what we are doing. And thereafter, we see the way forward. Akon is actually a short form of association of community organizations for reforms.
Now.
Association of community organizations for reforms now. As he said, Wed is the founder of the organization, that is Akon International. And we are just one of the 18 families of Akon all over the world. So maybe we'll be sharing on the same. The program actually started in Kenya after post-election violence of 2008. That was in 2009. After when we started organizing. That is the time where we actually came to Kenya to start off the program. And also that's the time through COPPA, Sam and I were recruited as the community organizers of Akon. And after looking around, we thought Kolkocho was the best settlement to launch the program. So we started off in two villages of High Ridge and Babadog, just as the piloting area of the program. Also, we didn't want to engage ourselves in very many areas for the purpose of the impact. And I think it's actually a membership organization. Through the organizing, we are able to recruit members. And these members are actually empowered to assist the organization in its, or rather funding its programs and activities through what we call use, that's membership contributions. So our members do that contributions to actually run our programs. Just like maybe the CEO, we don't actually go with the programs to the community. Of course, we engage the community. We select all of the community with assistance. We select issues. We're able to prioritize. And together with them, we try to find out a local solution. So when we went to Kolkocho, of course, we had so many issues that the community was able to select. Issues ranging from insecurity, unemployment among the youth, which is a serious issue. Statistics show that about 70% of the population of the country, they are youth. And more than 3/4 of them are unemployed. So that is actually a very serious issue in Kolkocho. So apart from that, we have the prostitution. We have issues to do with education. Remember, in Kolkocho we have only two public schools. That is Bonny and Gunyum, serving a population of almost 450,000. That's why Viale is able to come in to actually supplement the effort of the government. The issues of border security are very high. Child abuse, issues of that is domestic violence, plus others. So, when we launched the program officially, when we launched the program officially in 2010 is when also Mr. Wade came back to when we launched the program with a very big ceremony to the chief's camp. So we embarked on the educational campaign and the environmental campaign. Before the education campaign, we actually engaged the community on the environmental campaign. By then, the environment was in a pathetic situation. The drainage littering all over. And that could be, cause a lot of bother, especially during the rainy seasons. So we were able to engage by then the city council to actually start cleaning up programs within the culture. Because the aid officers there, they are collecting money in terms of cess to all the traders. There are so many, but they are not offering any services. They are just collect daily cess. So we were able to engage them in the community to make sure that by then the city council are able to start cleaning up programs. They are able to take their workforce together with the community, clear the trenches, and do the cleanups as they are doing in other areas. So that one was actually very successful. And then we embarked on the education campaign. And before that, we did baseline survey on the education situation, generally in agriculture, which had very startling statistics in the situation of the education in agriculture. And I remember we were able to convene a forum in which we disseminated the information. We shared the information with the various stakeholders who have programs in education, in agriculture, and in the neighboring estates. We are constantly mentioning neighboring estates like Ryobangi, Dandora, Kariadulu, and even Babadog, because there's a lot of interconnection, interlink with the Korokoto. There are so many people who are living in these neighboring estates who are working in the Korokoto. The others are working, are living in Korokoto, and they have business in these estates. So we did baseline survey in Korokoto, and we are able to disseminate the information with the stakeholders. That information really assisted us. It was Cairo will share. So many children were able to be absorbed in the public schools, and others were able to get space in other schools outside the Korokoto. So after the education campaign. Also, as another issue which was highly prioritized was actually insecurity. Before doing anything, as usual, we also did some baseline survey on the same, any figures. But this time we were afraid we could not share with other stakeholders because we had a sad instance. Before we could do anything with the education reporter, some organizations were already running with it again, starting their own programs on the research that we had done. So that one was not very good. That's why we have decided we will remain with our report and then implement it or carry it, the campaigns in our own way. So up to now, we are now embarking on drug abuse. Drug abuse, which is a serious problem again in Korokocho. So yeah, survey has already been done. And we are already doing something. I think that one Mr. Cairo will be able to share with the rest. So alongside we are able to recruit and locally train some local community organizers like Cairo here, plus others who assist us in terms of mobilization. Now, as a result of category crossing issues, we are forced to actually implement the programs in these other villages. We are unable to restrict ourselves to Tai Ridge and the Sumudog. We have an office, field office at Kadoban. That's about 2 kilometers. So from, if you happen to know Holy Trinity, on the way to Korokocho, we have a landmark, then we have Sanoda. So our office is at Sanoda, third floor. If you come there, you will at least get someone to assist you. So maybe the rest, what we've done on the ground, maybe Cairo, some can add a few things. Maybe Cairo can also contribute.
Okay, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
David has highlighted almost everything, but I can add a few. Because as you are doing the survey in education in Korokocho, we found that so many kids are not going to school. And as he has mentioned, Korokocho has only 2 public schools, primary schools. One is called Daniel Koponi Primary School, and the other one is Kunyumu Primary School, where I am the chairman of the school. So what we normally do, we did, after the survey, we started to look for these kids who are not going to school. And I remember in the year 2010, immediately after we launched ACON, I happened to mobilize 120 kids who joined St. Clair Primary School. It's a Catholic school. And we are very happy because these kids are supported. They buy uniforms, school fees, and also they cater for school feeding program. The other kids, we take them to Gunyomo Primary School, which is a government school. And I'm the chairman of the school management committee. So we have no difficulties when we fight such kids. From there, we found that there was also need for secondary dropouts. And you know, in Korogosho,
most of the parents there are single mothers. And when these kids sit for their KCP, they don't get a chance to go to secondary schools. So we decided to look for a partner who can also could be assisting us where we could be taking these kids. And now we are partnering with a school called Guleg Mixed School, which is in Isiwani. Guleg Secondary School. And in the year 2011, we happened to refer that the two kids. And in the year 2012, we referred 22 students. In the year 2013, 15. Last year, we referred 12. And this year, we referred 10 kids, 10 students. So that is what we are doing. And also, we have partnered with another organization called Home of Hope. They do the risking of kids, which are the kids who are abandoned. Maybe some kids are one day old. If you find them, we refer to Home of Hope, and they are taken care of by the organization. We also, maybe we risk some other girls, and there is an organization that we are partnering, a church that we are partnering with, called Word of Life Church. That's where we refer them. We also look for these men and women who live with HIV. And the same church, we refer them to the same church. So that's what we have been doing. So mainly my work in Korogosho is mobilization. And when they come up with a program, I'm not a professional. So they come and tell me, you want to do this and this and this. So my main work is mobilize, bring the community together. I call them, they come and talk with them. So and then after that, we look for the way forward. The other thing is also linking them with the other organizations, that can add value to what we are doing. And also we have been working with the professional administration, especially the chief. He knows us better. Whenever you are doing any program, we involve you. So the community know us, the government know us. So we have not been having difficulties in Korogosho. So that is what I can say for now. Maybe some can answer.
Yeah, just a slight additional. Along with when we are working in Korogosho, we've also been closely liaising with the COT. And among the members that we are working with, we look at people who are who can be able to be trained for higher engagement. And so far, we've been able to refer, I think there are four people who have been fully trained. In the year 2011, I think we referred one lady. Mariam, and she got employed and she is doing something else. Although she normally comes and support any activity that we have for Aquan. Then 2012 we had Naima, and there were two.
And also David and Makori.
Makori, yeah, there were two who got trained. Unfortunately, last year, but one. COT never trained. They did advanced training for those who had trained, but we had referred to them three. But unfortunately, they were not taken. But they are closely working with us, and there are people who have done their O level. They have passed, but yet they don't have any other option to go on with their life. They are only assisting us in the. The issues in Korogosho. So far, so good. Of course, we've been doing in Korogosho, and currently, as David has said, we are with a program of drugs addiction, and it's a big problem in Korogosho. And according to the survey that we did, it's amazing because out of 10 houses, at least 8 of them are directly or indirectly affected by issues of drugs. And it's so much. And the authority, normally it's like they are tied up, nothing they can do. Police who are located there, they know people who are selling, but they do nothing. Chief knows these people, does nothing. And in fact, even at one time, when we engaged the chief of Kariobangi, openly told us, I've taken 2 people twice for higher authority. But they are released. The next day I'm meeting them, and they are threatening me. So what do I do? So it's a huge, huge problem, huh? And we are risking, but we are saying as ACON, we'll do mobilization, we'll see what we can do, and do campaign against this. But for the time being, what we are doing currently, we are trying to reach out to those people using drugs so that they can stop using drugs. I don't know whether the sellers will turn against us soon, mm-hmm. but we hope we'll win the battle. That's it.
So, okay. Another thing maybe I've forgotten. In Korogosho, we have a lot of many Muslims, and we are working with them. They are very friendly, and we engage them. So whatever we do, we engage them. And that's why you have, some have said that we referred one Muslim lady to CAT, and now she's working, and we are the ones who helped her to get that employment. So we are working very well with Muslims in Korogosho.
Great.
So now maybe I wish to invite Wade for sharing, then we open the discussion. Wade is the founder of ACON International. He is also a great writer. He has written so many books. I don't think I can count them. There are so many. He'll tell us.
Not that many.
And he is a very experienced person. From the fact that ACON International started in the US, and it has spread into so many other countries so far. So welcome, Wade.
It's always good to be here. I know the first time I ever came to Nairobi, just as somebody trying to meet people, I was so impressed that there was something that was an association of community organizers. I wrote a blog, I went back to the United States and I said, why don't we have something like that? Well, people don't talk across the pews in the United States that well, so we don't, but it's always a pleasure to be here. Sorry Lawrence isn't with us, so I give him my greetings as always when we're here. He was always a big help, and certainly he helped once we finally made the decision that the violence was over and we were going to start ACORN Kenya. We've been trying for 2 years at that time. He was very helpful and connected me to David and Sammy and many others. So ACORN International, as David says, and all of the ACORN affiliates are membership organizations. So we're much more like a union in the community than we are an NGO. We are nonprofit, but it's all membership based, and members pay dues, whatever country they're in, according to their currency. Cairo is actually an elected leader. So one of our principles is these 10 plus, and you're right, the 11th is always nobody has any money. In community organizing, but the other one is we're a membership organization, and we have democracy is a very important part of what we do. Organizers have to be accountable to people. The best people to be accountable to are those people who are elected as leaders by the members, and that's the structure that we've had since the first meeting in June of 2009. We are involved with issues. It's a listening process, similar to your principles here in Copa Kenya. We listen for those issues, and we commit to our members that whatever issues they see as important, we'll get to, but we do We start with one that's specific, realizable, and winnable. The issues around the world we deal with are many just like the ones that my brothers have talked about here, but also are things like living wages, housing security and housing tenure, predatory financial institutions. And let me tell you what I mean by this. So in places like Quito, Ecuador, La Matanza outside of Buenos Aires, in Argentina, the Nesa in Mexico City, or in Peru, in San Luis Arancho. Here the issue are large mega slums, even larger than Coragocho, but there's no land ownership, there's no land security. So the fight in many of these areas is getting potable water, getting infrastructure, building roads, building schools, and very important to people, going through the process and figuring out how these little homemade structures that they've made their home can eventually be their land. The laws are different everywhere. It's, you know, 5 years in Ecuador, it's 8 years in Buenos Aires, we looked it up here, it's 12 years in Kenya, we started talking before this session. These are critical issues, as you can imagine, as families try to improve what outsiders see as slums, but which people who live there see as home. And we respect the decisions that both people have made and the economy has forced people to make. So these are common issues lots of places. In the developed countries, Canada, Italy, the United Kingdom, tenant and landlord issues are very important to what ACORN does. In Rome, we've won huge issues forcing landlords to refund 90% of the rent to their tenants for up to 8 years, which is the term of a lease in Rome, in anywhere in Italy. In the UK, where it was common to have social housing or public housing, now private tenancy and landlords are taking hold. We've been among the first organizations to try to get a charter of rights for tenants in terms of dealing with landlords and letting agencies in the UK. In terms of living wages, no matter where you go in the globe, low and moderate income families, and ACORN anywhere only works with low and moderate income families. This problem of stagnant wages and minimum wages set by law for workers in different classifications, but frozen, whether it's the United States where we haven't had an increase in minimum wages for now 9 years and likely to be longer, or in other countries, part of what we do is try to push state governments, national governments, local municipalities, even going on ballot measures and putting the issues to a vote to raise the wage floor. And in the United States, we've been involved in more than 100 of these campaigns. We won the first living wage ordinance in Canada, in the Vancouver area. And what we won was a minimum wage, if you can imagine this, for these contract employees of $16.23, indexed to inflation. So now they make $17.50. In most of the ACORN world, we all say, we're ready to move to Vancouver. You know, let us go where there's a living wage that actually pays a living wage. In Toronto, we're trying to fight for $11, $12. In Ottawa, the same. These problems in the United Kingdom are such that you can only deal with them nationally. You can't deal with them at the level of London or Bristol or Edinburgh or anywhere else. In places like India, this kind of work in terms of how to get more protected and stable working conditions for low-wage families in our communities has led to the organization of unions and associations of informal workers. So we now have a India-wide, a union of informal workers, largely street vendors, but some domestic workers, rickshaw pullers. Largely 35,000 of those members are in the southern part of India, Bengaluru, Chennai, Ahmedabad, but also in Delhi, the capital, where we have 2,000 members, and Mumbai, where we have a co-op of recyclers. But we now have 40,000 members there of the overall 160,000 members in Acorn International globally. As a membership organization, we end up going where our membership says. We have no restrictions that say we're organized in a way that the government can tell us, no, you can't do this. Or if the members raise their hands and say, this is a good idea, crazy as it may seem, let's go after the drug problem in Korogochu, what are we going to do? We go after the drug problem in Korogochu and cast, any doubts to side. The same with workers, when our members have said, we don't have a union, we don't have a way to raise wages, we don't have a way to be able to sell on the streets without police harassment and being pushed off of our livelihoods, we've ended up organizing unions there and then in other places in the country and the world. So originally, when ACORN began in the United States, we started globally just following our members. They were in the Dominican Republic, they were in Mexico, they were in Canada. They saw success in their local groups in the United States. Why can't we have that back in our home countries? Over time, over the last dozen years that ACORN International has been working, we've expanded significantly in Latin America, not only Mexico and Dominican Republic, but also Honduras, Ecuador, Peru, Argentina. India, we followed a campaign about workers' rights there and have offices throughout India. Kenya, we came because we met a number of people in Kenya over the years and couldn't say no. And I loved hearing Sammy and David say, well, they're with ACORN now at this time. Well, it's been 6 years, men, so I think we're going to be together a long time. Our work's a long way from done, and that's part of the commitment that ACORN makes, is that we're not a project, we're not an NGO, we're not government funded, we're not particularly even foundation funded. Our commitment is to those members. As long as they're there and paying dues, we're there one way or another. We support the work through social enterprises. We have two coffee houses in New Orleans that are fair trade, that support particularly our Kenyan office, our Indian offices in Latin America. Obviously, some of our partnerships with unions mean that they sometimes contribute to the work we're doing. Some individuals obviously get excited about the work and, you know, the money comes. But basically, it's that support from our members that makes the difference. The last couple of years have seen us not growing in new countries, but more growing where we are, other than in the United Kingdom. We've opened 6 offices in the last 2 years, thanks to the strength of a program that supported community organizers. So these community organizers wanted to actually build something. They contacted us. They were already being paid. So now they're running as fast as the money is there to build up the membership to be able to support the organization. We probably now have close to 1,000 members in the UK. And most recently in France, where we've affiliated an organization, Alliance Citoyenne, in Grenoble. We're training organizers to go to work in Paris starting in January. And very interestingly, and part of that affiliation and partnership, they had an organization that worked largely in the Francophone countries in Africa. And this was very exciting to us because we want to partner what they're doing with what we were doing here in places like Kenya. They have a project in Liberia, Cameroon, Ivory Coast, Morocco, and the Congo, organizing palm oil and rubber plantation workers on the rural agricultural side to try to get justice from a very, very large multinational company called Bolloré. And those rural organizations, membership organizations, are now in the process of affiliating in their countries to be the ACORN affiliate, the Ivory Coast ACORN or the Cameroon ACORN. We're also working to build a domestic workers union in Morocco. So this has been exciting. David and Sammy and I have been having some different kind of conversations for a change about how we can link them to Liberia, because there they speak English. Our French affiliate is troubled that they aren't doing a good enough job. In fact, when I was in Grenoble 3 weeks ago, they handed me the phone and said, can you try to see what's going on? So we're trying to see if we can link the work we're doing here with the work in Liberia, another project that they're interested in expanding in Nigeria, but so that we end up with a larger footprint in Africa based on this kind of membership growth. So we're involved in actions, we're involved in campaigns, we're a democratic membership organization, we organize unions, we organize tenants, we organize communities. Our main emphasis in India, Latin America, and obviously in Africa is in the mega slums, or in, as I've said, with this new partnership, potentially issues that involved land grabbing, where these plantations are trying to push out small farmers and producers and take their land. So you go where the work is. Somehow around this room, whether it's 1993 or it's, you know, whatever year people came in and said that they were trained, or whenever my friend looked the other way and was elected as the chair of Acorn Kenya, this is work for life. I'm honored to have been doing this work since 1968, and then obviously starting Acorn in 1970. You know, in the beginning you think, well, maybe it's a revolution, we'll win quickly. And it turns out it's a marathon. And, you know, I'm 45 years in with Acorn. You may be 5 years, 10 years, 26 or whatever, but this is God's work here. This is the people's mission, and it's a rare opportunity that we get to both struggle and win. And it's always good to be in a community like you have here in Nairobi and in Kenya, of community organizers that can share the good times and the hard times that come with doing this work. So I'm open to any questions. It's always a delight to be here.